there's so many hurting people out there everywhere we go. There's just people come into the church for benevolence and hope. They're here at the food pantry. And I just really feel like what Jesus is really all about was people. And so we have all these ministries that just do an incredible job of helping people. We are so blessed with the best volunteers that they just continue to make things happen. Even, for example, the food pantry, it has grown so much in the last 9 years. And I feel really blessed at this church to have so many people step up in faith and say, I want to do things for others.
It also gives the church, meaning the people, an opportunity to help and assist, provide the needs for those people who are in need, at the same time providing not only the food and the clothing, and also prayer when they come here. I think that's very key, and to know that they are a part of a bigger picture.
While Jesus was on earth, he used physical needs to point to spiritual needs and spiritual truths. So our goal is to pattern our lives more around Jesus, so that's why we're here. The church empowers us more than individually, because on our own we wouldn't be able to meet all these needs, and God calls us to work as the body of Christ, as a community.
Well, I think when you think about why bother with the church, or why be a part of a church rather than any other club or any other thing, the Spirit of God lives here, and He lives within you and within me. And when we get together and we gather in His name and we pray about things and we work together, all together, many hands make light work. I've always said that. And we have that here. We have so many programs that just continue to grow because of people that want to see the heart of Jesus expressed at the church, outside of the church, and in the city. We want to make an impact for Jesus.
Every day, day and night, we breathe. Stop breathing, stop living. It's the way it works. Breathe in, breathe out. We hardly notice it becomes the rhythm of our life. And that's the way our life as the body of Christ, as the church, should be. We should let the Holy Spirit of God breathe us out into our neighborhoods, to our schools, to our workplaces, to our social gatherings, and breathe us out. And we're still the church while we're there scattered. But then the Spirit of God breathes us back in together into community. And there's things that happen when we're together, when God breathes us into His presence together. And I believe if we're not experiencing that, being the church scattered and being the church gathered, whether it's in a church service like this, a growth group, having dinner with Christian friends and talking about faith things, together as Christians, scattered as Christians, the stuff we saw up on the screen there with community outreach, that doesn't happen just because we're scattered. We come together, we give, we plan, and then we have over 30 ministries here in Monterey that we do as a body on this campus and all around this community because we gather together. It's part of what we do. It's the way God has made us. And we live in a world where there's just not this awareness of the power and the strength and the value of the church. Why bother with the church? We talked last week about the fact I had a high chair up here, and then a little steak and potatoes meal over here, and baby food and a bottle and steak and potatoes. And we talked about why gather as God's people. Why be the church gathered? Because we start as Christians as newborn babies, and we want to grow spiritually. The Apostle Paul says, don't just keep drinking spiritual milk, but you got to eat the meat and potatoes of your faith. How do we grow? It happens when we're together. One of the best ways to grow is to be together, to worship, to learn. And so we're pressed forward in growth. We become what we long to become and what God wants us to become when we follow Jesus scattered and gathered. Today we're talking about the reality that, you know, why bother with the church? Because I was created for community. You were hardwired in your mother's womb, in the very soul of who you are. You were made for community. But that's changing. Our world is changing. Before the 1930s, living rooms, the furniture in living rooms, was generally in a circle or in an oval or in a rectangle. All the furnishing faced inward towards nothing, because when you sat, you looked at each other, human eyes to human eyes and hearts to hearts. And after the 1930s, it started to change. What changed was monitors, a TV monitor. Look at the screen up here where it says, "Why bother?" Now, you probably have one in your living room. That's probably smaller than yours. You probably have a big monitor in your living room. But what's happened in our culture is now all the furniture, and you check it when you go home, for the most part, the furnishing in our living rooms isn't in a circle anymore. It's in a half circle, all facing what? The monitor, the TV. There's people that study these sorts of things, and Kleiner Perkins, interesting corporation, interesting, if you look at their website, just very diversified, lots of things, but one of the things they do is they study how much time human beings spend looking at monitors. They do a survey every year. Here's what they learned about the United States and America. The average American across all of America, that means some are more than this, some are less, the average American spends 147 minutes a day in front of a TV monitor. Average American, 147 minutes a day. Average American spends 103 minutes a day in front of a computer monitor. That's in addition to their 147 minutes in front of the TV. Again, the average American, get this, spends 151 minutes a day looking at the monitor on their phone. And the average American also spends an average of 43 minutes a day looking at a tablet. Add them all up, and you have 444 minutes a day, 7.2 hours a day for the average American, which means there's lots of Americans that spend more time than that staring at a monitor. And what's happening, and just so you know, I have a TV, I have a computer, I have an iPad, and I have a phone. I'm not anti-technology. But we have to acknowledge something. We spend a lot of life doing this when there's a human being right behind it. Right? And things are changing, the way we furnish our homes and organize our homes and organize our lives. And God says, I've made you for community, and a community that goes beyond just looking at monitors. Sometime back, a group came together and they made a movie, trying to create a picture I'm going to show you a clip of this movie in a moment. It's this dark, dark prophetic picture of this dystopic future where people are just locked on monitors all the time. I want you to brace yourself for this dark prophetic vision of our future. Watch the screens.
Over to the driving range and hit a few virtual balls in space.
Nah, we did that yesterday. I don't want to do that.
Well, then what do you want to do?
I don't know. Something. Wow.
Make a play. Scream.
Not jealous.
No, it doesn't.
Look, I'm tired of it.
If you can't fold the straw, it's not
yet
really deciding
any good.
Bot, over here.
Whoa.
Does that send a chill down your spine? Some of you are like, when can I have a bot bring me a drink? And when do I get the floating chair? That's not the point of the video. An animated cartoon, but it's giving this picture of a future where people are more prone to look at a monitor than to look at another. The opening of the scene is cute and sad. Two people floating on their little chairs next to each other, talking to each other, but they don't turn and look eye to eye. They talk monitor to monitor. Now, again, the point is not that these tools and resources are bad. But we need to be careful because God has hardwired our souls to be in community. And what I want to think about today is why this is so important and how particularly, why do I need the community of God's family? What happens uniquely when we're together like this in a worship service in the same space, meeting in the foyer as you come in, talking to each other, hanging out afterwards and interacting, being in a growth group in somebody's living room where you're talking to each other, having a meal with Christian friends and talking about things of faith, being Christians together in community, why does it matter so much? And number one, why do I need the community of God's family? Number one is this, because in the depth of my soul, I know that I was created for community. In the depth of who I am, I know that I need God's people, even when there's moments I'm not sure if I want them. You know what I'm saying? I mean, we struggle sometimes. Do I really want this? But deep inside, I know I need to be gathered with God's people. Genesis 2:18 says this. The Lord God said, "It is not good for the man to be alone. I will make a helper suitable for him. God's created the entire universe. He creates a person, puts them in paradise. They've got everything. And God says, something's missing. So I'm going to make a helper suitable. That word helper is the same, a word that's used for the Holy Spirit, a partner, one who comes near. And God said, when God finally brought together a man and a woman, when he established community, God says, this is very good. In our soul, we need community, even when we don't know we need it. We know deep in our soul that we do. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, the Apostle Paul is talking about the church, the body of Christ. And he uses this image of a human body and compares it to how we function together, or at least how we should function together as the church. So in 1 Corinthians 12, verse 12, we read this. Just as a body, a physical body, though one has many parts, but all the parts form one body, so it is with Christ. He bridges to the spiritual. Just like our physical body has all these different parts, but we're really one person, a holistic person, so the church is lots of people, but we're still one body of Christ. Verse 13. For we were all baptized by one Spirit so as to form one body. Then the Apostle Paul takes hold of two of the most diverse kinds of people in the world at that time, whether Jews or Gentiles, very different from each other in that time, slave or free, radically different at that time in history. And we were all given the one Spirit to drink. Once the Holy Spirit's in us, we're a family. Even so, the body is not made up of one part, but of many. Do you get the picture? He's saying we belong to each other. We're connected. Whether we know it or not, whether we like it or not, whether we want to be part of it or not, we are connected as a body of Christ. Now, here's what I know. I know for a lot of people, that puts them off. Because there's people that have been part of the church and they've been hurt by people in the church. And they say, man, if that's what the church is like, if people in the church are like that, I want nothing to do with it. Some of you have had those experiences. Can I tell you, some of my most wonderful, blessed, amazing moments in all my life have been among God's people in the church. And some of my most painful, difficult, vicious attacks on me and my family have been in the church. I'm not kidding myself by saying, oh, everybody in the church is lovely and easy to get along with. That's not necessarily true. But here's the question. In light of all of that, will you commit to press into community rather than avoid it? Will you commit to say, I will gather with God's people. I will, if I can do it, I'll get in a growth group. I will come to church services and I'll make a point of coming and gathering. And we have people watching on a monitor right now at home. We have military folks that are parts of the world where you can't get to a church. Stay online. That's the best we can do. We love you. We miss you. And we have people online who have physical challenges. They're in bed right now. And there's 100 plus people that are in the service right now with us in other places. If you're in bed right now and you can't get out of bed, we're glad you're with us. You're a family. We love you. But if you're at home right now in Monterey and you could be here right now, get off your monitor next week and come here. Okay? I love you. Or go to Pacific Grove. If you speak Spanish, go to Iglesias Shoreline. But there's something about... Was that too harsh? Was I okay there? We love you. But there's something about being together that's extremely important as a part of the body of Christ. My wife and I had a guy who influenced our lives hugely, younger in faith and young in ministry. We were going through seminary together. And this guy, Harold Corver, this great, wise pastor. Harold Corver, actually his grandson, Kyle Corver, just got traded to the Cavs, and he's going to be trouble. I think he's going to be trouble for the Warriors down the road. That's a different sermon. But Kyle Corver's grandpa is a pastor, and he's influenced Sherry and I quite a bit. And Harold Corver had these great little sayings he would say about the church that really spoke to my heart. Here was one of them. This has never left my mind. Harold Corver said, in the church, you will always have the healthiest of humanity. And in the church, you will always have the sickest of humanity in every way possible. And then he said this. That's the way it's always been. That's the way it always will be. And that's the way it should be. Because we're the church. As a young pastor getting ready to be a pastor, I'm like, whoa. You know, I want to think of the church as all nice, highly functioning, healthy, happy people who treat you nice. But I've been a pastor too long to believe that. There's people who are broken and in pain in the church. And you've been hurt by them and so have I. But you don't at that point say, I'm done with it. I'm out of here. I'm only breathing out and never coming together with God's people. You'll die out there without coming together with God's people. And so acknowledge that it's difficult and say, I'm going to draw together in community with God's people, even when it's tough, because I was made for community. If you call Shoreline Church your church home and you've never become a member, I want to challenge you on the 29th. I'm leading a membership class, and I encourage you to come to that class and find out about what membership means. this has been your church for 6 months or 6 years or 20 years and you've never joined, I want to challenge you to consider that. Be open. And if you're military or only here for a time, we actually have a ministry partnership covenant where people say, I'm here for the next 14 months and I will become a ministry partner with Shoreline for that time. I'll keep my membership somewhere else, but I'll be a ministry partner. I invite you to come be part of the class on the 29th and learn more about this. But we need the community of God's people because in the depth of our soul, we know it, we feel it. We were made for community. Number two, why do we need community of God's family? Because this is where I am loved and where I learn to extend love to others. It's in the church we learn to love the easy, wonderful, gracious people and the difficult, hard, stubborn, cantankerous, mean, nasty. I'm not looking at anybody. I'm just saying there's people in the church that are tough, right? It's where we learn to love and to be loved. I've learned more about loving. I was in my family, my parents' home for 17 and a half years, and I went off to college. You know, and I had time in and out of their home, but really, I mean, there was a point where I kind of was out of their home. I've been in God's family for over 40 years. I've learned a lot about loving people in the church. Wonderful, sweet people and challenging people. This is where we learn to love. I love what Jesus says in John chapter 13. If you have your Bibles, look at John 13, 34, and then we'll jump to another passage in John 15. But in John 13, 34, Jesus says, a new command I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. How will the world know that we're followers of Jesus? How we love each other. And then in John 15, verse 12, Jesus says, this is my command. My command is this. Love each other. I love this. As I have loved you. How am I to love you and you and you and you? How? Just the way Jesus loves me. Oh, easy. How's that going for you, right? How you doing loving the other Christians around you just the way Jesus loves you? It stretches you. It challenges you. But this is what we do. We gather together and we learn to love one another so the world can see. So here's the question. What does the world see when they look at you love other Christians? What does the world see when they see how you love other Christians? What are they observing? What are they seeing? Do people look and say, there must be a God because I can see how you love other Christians and it's challenging sometimes. They say, oh man, there's got to be a God because look at how those Christians love each other. Sherry and I were out for dinner with some dear friends of ours, and I would say they're not, at this point, they're probably not committed Christians, don't go to a church regularly, but they've become very dear friends. We were out to dinner and talking, and one of the people in this couple just started observing things about people from Shoreline. They live in the Monterey area, so they run into lots of Shoreline people. And they said, you know, every time I interact with somebody from Shoreline, I find out they're from Shoreline. They said, they're different. I said, say more, because different has lots of translations, right? And they said, no, they're different. Like, they're warmer, and they have this sort of happiness, and they like other, and they like each other. They like being together. And they started observing what I'm telling you. And this is probably some of you sitting in this room. You have influenced this couple who we love and care about, that we're longing for the day that they would come to put their full faith and trust in Jesus. But they're being influenced by you out there in this community. The way you love each other and the way you love Jesus. It speaks volumes. It's powerful. And so I just want to challenge you to say, how am I loving other Christians? I meet with a group of pastors this last Friday. Spent almost 2 hours with Pastor Rick from Carmel Press, with Pastor Dave from Gathering by the Bay, and with Pastor Ben from Cypress Church. And I need to tell you, I love these brothers. I love them. I would do anything for them. I would take a bullet for them. I love them. They are my brothers. You say, well, no, they're pastors of other local churches. They're the competition. Right? No. No. They love Jesus. We love Jesus. We're in this together. How do you love the other Christians in our community? Do you bless them? Do you encourage them? Do you celebrate what God is doing? And I want to challenge you. You want to learn to extend love, get close to a few other Christians. This is why growth groups are so important. And we're launching 2 weeks from now, a 4-week series all in, and we have all kinds of new growth groups on our website. We have room for new people to jump in growth groups. Just a 4-week commitment and then evaluate if you want to keep doing it. But I tell you what, when you get with a group of people week by week, regularly, up close, and you're not set up in a semicircle, you're all looking at each other, you learn to love when it's easy and you learn to love when it's tough. You get to be the church together. And I want to challenge you as your pastor to think about that and to pray about that. Number three, Why do we need the community of God's family? Because we are safer together. And if you're a note taker, there's notes in the bulletin. I would say because we are safer and stronger together. We need each other in the church because we are safer together and we are stronger when we stand together. And so God breathes us by his spirit. And most of our week, we're the church scattered most of our week. We're out there in the world. But when God breathes us by his spirit back together into your growth group to get together with Christian friends, coming to church service, when God brings us together, there's this sense of we're together with people who stand with us, who have our back, who encourage us, and we need that desperately. Ecclesiastes chapter 4, verse 12. A verse often used in weddings, but it's very appropriate just for our normal life of faith. Ecclesiastes 4:12 says this, though one may be overpowered, two can defend themselves. A cord of three strands is not quickly broken. It's saying if you're out there on your own, man, you might be defenseless. You might be attacked and might get in all kinds of trouble. But if you have another person alongside of you or two other people, if you're in a group of people, man, you can stand strong. I was thinking about this, and I had in my picture, I had in my mind this picture of all of these different, this footage of the African plains where there's different wild animals, and they're going after like a herd of this of some kind of animal, and the predators come around the edges of the herd. They don't go in the middle because they'll get killed there. They get on the edges and they look for somebody a straggler, someone who wanders off, right? And they attack. So I asked our video team, would you give me a couple of examples of this because I want to show it in a service, right? So they sent me three examples of a lion, I think it was a cheetah, and of a hyena. And all three of the, I sat and watched them on my office. All three of the videos ended the same way. With a weak stray animal getting chewed up and bloody and gory. So I wanted to show, no, we're not going to show it. I watched all three of them. They had it all written. I said, let's not show it. I'll just talk about it. But here's the deal. All three scenarios turned out the same. The predators came around the edge of the herd and found the ones that were wandering, that were strays, the ones that were out there and never kind of didn't get in the middle of things. And one by one, they picked them off. And I thought of 1 Peter chapter 5. We're inspired by the Holy Spirit. Peter says, do you not know that your enemy is like a prowling lion seeking someone to devour? You're going to spend most of your life breathed out by the Spirit, the church scattered, and praise God. Go be the presence of Jesus wherever he sends you. But make sure you come together with the herd. You come together with God's people. You get in the middle of things because there is strength and there is encouragement and there is power in being among God's people. My question is this. Whose back do you have and who has your back? Whose back do you have? Who has your back? Who will stand back to back with you when the attack comes on? Can I tell you something? There's a bunch of people in this church that I know would take a bullet for me. They love me and they would stand with me. And so would Ben and Dave and Rick, pastors from other local churches. We need the body of Christ. We need to stand together. And my whole Christian journey, I have experienced this over and over again. When my mom passed away, sort of unexpected, it came out almost out of nowhere. And her health just dropped rapidly. She had a complete shutdown of multiple vital organs, and she died. And when I did I did her funeral on a Saturday, the day before my first Sunday preaching at Shoreline Church. I did it Saturday. I preached here for my first time as a pastor of this church on Sunday. And sitting in that place down in Orange County were a group of men from this church who came down to surround me, to have my back, and to be there with me. I need that. I still need it today. And I want to be that for other Christians. When Sherry and I moved to Monterey, we learned something. Homes here are expensive. I'm not a real sharp guy, but it became apparent very quickly. And we didn't know if we'd even be, we got turned down for, we just tried, turned down. And this was like near the bottom of the market when they were super cheap, expensive. And we got turned down, and we thought we're not gonna be able to get a house. That would be okay. We get an apartment, whatever. But God opened a door for us to get a house. And the day before we were supposed to close and do all this stuff, the bank said, oh, by the way, and they did all these changes and stuff, and we were basically going to lose the loan and lose the house. It was somebody, a Christian brother, who came to me and said, what's it going to take to get you in that house? I said, it can't be done. I need to have this amount of money to pay for it right now. He says, give me a number, I'll wire the money, pay for the house, and you pay me back as soon as you can get a loan. Who does that? I said, well, can I pay you interest on it? He says, no, we're Christians. Who does that? We do, because we're a family. We have each other's backs. That's the church. My dad, who's far from Jesus, he's closer than he's been, but he still hasn't come to know Jesus. There are hundreds of people in this church that pray faithfully for my dad. And they come, you guys, you come and tell me at times, I'm praying for your dad. How's your dad doing? That's what the church is. You don't get that when you're just out there alone as a Christian. You got to be part of the body of Christ. And so I want to just challenge you to say, God, as we gather, will you strengthen us and make us strong for the world? You listen to those different ministries that Deb talked about on the video this morning, right before the sermon. You know, these different, you know, food pantry, clothing closet. But it goes on and on. Over 30 ministries will happen this year on this campus and in our community to help people. And that happens because you all gather together. You give, you pray, you serve. We can't do that when we're scattered. To change our world, we have to gather. And you know what? We know the world needs it. They don't. But we do this because we are the body of Christ. We are God's family. We are safer and we are stronger when we're together. Number four, I need the community of God's family because anywhere I travel all over the planet, God's people are there. I need to recognize that I'm part of something bigger than Monterey and Shoreline. I am part of God's family all over the world. You travel anywhere in the world, you will find a Christian church. And here's my challenge to you. If you travel for business, vacation, wherever you go, find a Christian church and go worship with them. Well, what if I don't know the words of the songs? What if they speak a different language? You know what? You'll just sit there. I've sat in churches where I didn't understand a word they sang. And I felt the presence of God's Spirit and I knew I was with family. And when the preacher got up and preached, I didn't understand a word they said. They were speaking a language I didn't know. But I felt God's presence. I was among God's people. Pastor Roy, who is a kind of Monterey guy, he's our family life pastor, Monterey guy, kind of his whole life here. We made him go on an international mission trip because he had never done one. We forced him to, didn't we? We forced him. And so we thought we'd start out easy and we sent him to Nepal. Have a nice trip, Roy. Pray for Pastor Roy. He's on a 5-week sabbatical right now. And that's hard for him too. He didn't want to go on a sabbatical. We made him take a sabbatical. Pray that God will refresh him, bless him, and bring him back ready to keep leading our family life ministries. But we sent Pastor Roy to Nepal and he found out with these little kids and these folks doing Awana in Nepal, in the inner city, in the painful place in Nepal, it's the family of God. It's his family. Now, Roy's not rushing off to other parts of the world to do more mission trips. He likes being here. But he found out he's got family everywhere. That's what we need to learn. I shared last week about worshiping in the jungles of El Salvador. The whole service in Spanish, except for when we were preaching, they were translating. And it was family. First time I preached in Geneva, Switzerland, there's a massive international community there. And I preached to this church that was even more diverse than Shoreline. Sure, we had people from all over the world here, but this was like people from all over the world. And as I preached and as I was there with those people, we were invited over for dinner. This couple, Gary and Silky, invited us to their home for dinner. Within 5 minutes of sitting at their table, they introduced to a food called raclette. It's a melted cheese, really tasty. But 5 minutes at their table, and I'm looking at them going, family, this is our family. We're part of something much bigger than us, but you don't experience it if all you are is the church scattered. You experience it when you become part of God's church gathered, and that's a gift, and that's a blessing. Number five, why do we need the community of God's family? Because I need to be reminded that my beliefs and convictions are not strange or crazy, and sometimes I think I'm going crazy in this world. That the things that are bedrock beliefs that I'm committed to, a lot of people in the world don't get it and don't embrace it and don't agree with it. And we've got to look and say, God, I want to understand that what you speak to me is true, even if our world doesn't buy into it. And so I look with me at 2 Timothy chapter 4. In 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 3 and 4, we read this. For a time will come when people will not put up with sound doctrine. Instead, to suit what their own desires, they will gather around them a great number of teachers who say what their itching ears want to hear. They will turn their ears away from the truth and turn aside to myths. And we live in a world where there's all kinds of things being told and, you know, promoted, and people go, oh, that sounds good. I believe that. And what we believe as Christians is so unique and so countercultural that if we don't get together with each other sometimes and go, are we okay? Am I crazy? Is this right? We're gonna lose it. Because our world sees things so radically different. So my question is this. Are you propelled confidently into the world because you have been with God's people and been reminded of God's truth? Do you get to leave being with God's people in a growth group, in a Bible study, in a church service, and just strengthened and propelled back out confident that you're not going crazy, but that you're okay? One of the things that I look at that is a challenge for me is generosity. Sherry and I are trying to be generous at a level beyond what we've ever been generous before. I mean, we have taken God's challenge to look at everything we have and try to make it available for his kingdom. And no, we can't take it with us. We're trying to become more and more generous. Sometimes I go, am I just crazy? Is this just crazy to keep being this aggressively generous? Except for the Bible says it and God's people know this. But when I get out there in the world, I think, man, does this make sense? And here's the truth from the world's perspective. No. But the last week and a half, Sharon and I had a dinner with a couple, and I had a lunch with an individual person. And all this couple from Shoreline and this individual person from Shoreline, we just met to have a meal and hang out. But in the conversation, in both cases, the conversation of generosity came up. I was gathered with some of God's people, just in a little cluster, and we were talking about the things of God. And this couple and this individual spoke about generosity and a passion to give, and try to take what they have and more use it for Jesus. And it inspired me. And it caused me to say, maybe I'm not crazy. Maybe there's still people like that out there that believe in the work of Jesus so much, they'll take everything they have and put it on the line. And it inspired me. And from being with those Christians at that lunch and at this dinner, I was just propelled back out saying, I'm not crazy. There's nothing more important than what we're doing here. It changed me being with them. What a blessing that was. I believe that people need Jesus, whether they know it or not. And when I get with God's people, I'm reminded of that. We have a group called the Outreach Influence Team. It's a group of every leader from every ministry at Shoreline. We meet every 30 days, and Pastor Tom reminds us that sharing the love of Jesus with our world is the most important thing we could ever do. And I'm reminded this isn't craziness. This is the call of Jesus. You watched the video with Deb earlier before the sermon, and people in the community outreach ministry going out. You know, why would you spend a Saturday and go help people that are struggling and that maybe don't even want to help themselves? That's craziness. But you get with other Christians, you go, no, this isn't craziness. This is the call of Jesus. This is the love of Jesus. We do these things that the world may say is crazy, but when I get with other Christians, I go, okay, we might be unique and different, but we have it right, and we get propelled outward. Number six, I need the community of God's family. Because I need to keep learning that we can be united in diversity and unified without uniformity. I need to be among people who are united in the things of Christ, but we're also unique, distinct people. Galatians 3, 26 to 28 says this. So in Christ, you are all children of God through faith. Not just everybody, but if you come to God through faith in Jesus, we become part of a family. We're children of God. For all of you were baptized into Christ and have clothed yourselves with Christ. Now listen to this. There's neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free, nor is there male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. This is not saying that men and women aren't different. This is not saying that, you know, what it's saying is when you know Christ and when we're bound together in the Spirit of Christ, all those other differences, they just don't feel like differences anymore because we're in the work of Jesus together. And we're united in that together, that we can be unified. So the question is this. Will you embrace and love Christians who look, sound, and think, even think differently than you? Will you embrace and love Christians who look, sound, and even think differently than you? And if you won't do that, you can't really be part of a church. Because people are going to have different perspectives. And I love this quote from some St. Augustine or Augustine, depending on how you want to pronounce it, both are fine, of Hippo. Said this centuries ago, in essentials, unity, in non-essentials, liberty, in all things, charity. I love that. In essentials, we're united. Salvation comes through Jesus Christ alone. We're united. This book is God's word beginning to end. We have to be united. We believe in one God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. We have to be united. And so in those critical essentials, we're unified. In non-essentials, liberty. Non-essentials. How should you dress when you go to church? Well, look around Shoreline. The answer is any way you want to. That's not an essential, right? You say in non-essentials, end times. How are things going to wrap up at the end of time? When's Jesus going to return? That's an important thing, but it's not like we have to all agree on our view of eschatology or the end times. We can have different perspectives. Can you have a glass of wine if you're a Christian? A lot of people say, I sure hope so, or I'm in trouble, right? That's a non-essential. Some Christians say, I don't feel comfortable doing that. Some say, but that's not an essential. So within those things, we have liberty. We have wisdom and liberty. But in all things, charity. Whatever you're dealing with, show kindness. That's what the body of Christ does. If there's one place and one group of people in our crazy, divided, you know, conflict-oriented world where people can say, I disagree, but I still love you. I disagree, but I'll still walk with you. It should be the church. Sherry and I spent 4 days in Orlando this last week at a leadership gathering. Probably 60, 70% of the people there would be people theologically, it was all church leaders. Would be people theologically I line right up with. 25, 30% people I don't line up with exactly theologically. But they've come to the cross, they've received Jesus, and they put their faith in him. And so there was kindness and grace extended, and I can sit with somebody and have a great conversation and disagree with them and still love them. So we need to find out what it looks like to be bound together as God's people, even when we have differences. And then number 7, why do we need the community of God's family? Because I need regular examples of what it looks like to live for Jesus in a world that presents a radically different picture of what's normal. I need people I can look at and respect as Christians and see how they're walking and get right in their footsteps and follow after them and learn from them. As a young Christian, there was a guy named Doug. And he was a committed Christian, about 2 years older than me, but he served people with just this ferocious commitment. He would just serve and serve and serve. And I just tried to get in his footsteps and become like Doug. Because listen to what the Apostle Paul says in 1 Corinthians. You want to memorize a verse today? Here's the easiest one to memorize. 1 Corinthians 11:1. So 1 Corinthians 11:1, and this is all it says. Follow my example as I follow the example of Christ. Isn't that great? Paul says, you just get my footsteps and follow my example as I follow Jesus. When you see somebody following Jesus, get in their footsteps and follow them. Become like them. I did that with Doug. It taught me how to serve in a way I'd never done it before. And I can go through my whole history of the handful of churches that I've been part of over the years. A guy named Chuck Van Ingen, a church I pastored down in Orange County area. And this church... Chuck was held the chair of theology of world missions for the largest seminary in the world. Brilliant guy. Students could turn papers into him in 6 different languages. Brilliant guy. And I watched how he read the Bible. I watched how he did theology. I watched how he thought. And I just got right in his footsteps. And I followed after him. If I was just the church scattered, I would have never been able to follow in Chuck's footsteps. You got to be with God's people to learn from them and to grow from them. I learned to pray with passion by watching Emma Jureen Burgess. Emma Jureen would come to the campus of the church, and she would walk the perimeter of the church a number of times, and she'd go home. And I found out she was praying 3-4 days a week. She'd walk and pray and walk. She'd surround the church and pray. I wish there were 5 or 10 people at Shoreline that when you drive by here midweek, if you happen to come down Highway 68, you just pull right in, park your car, and just walk our property one time and pray, get back in your car and head off and just pray for God's protection and God's blessing. But I watched Emma Jureen, and I learned about prayer through watching Emma Jureen. I just got in her footsteps and followed after her. Here at Shoreline, I've learned from so many of you. There's 2 couples that come to my mind as I was thinking and praying about this. Tim and Della Cass and Rick and Veronica Alexander. I figured out that between the four of those people, they've invested over about 70 years of serving at Shoreline Church. 70 years of rolling up mats, stinky mats, and setting up chairs in the school when Shoreline was in the school. Of serving on leadership team, of opening their home to people. Of giving. Of praying, of serving, of what can we do, of being part of community outreach. Those 2 couples, I honestly, in my time at Shoreline, if I want to be inspired to really follow Jesus and love people, I just get in the footsteps of those 2 couples. And I love being around them because every time I'm with them, I get inspired to serve more. If I'm scattered and not with God's people, I can't walk in the footsteps of people who are doing better than me. But when we gather, you look around, you find someone who's living more than you are towards Jesus, and you get in their footsteps and you learn from them. In just a moment, the Holy Spirit is going to breathe you out to be the church scattered. I pray that being the church gathered is so much a part of your life that it's like breathing. I wouldn't miss it, or I'm going to die. I need the breath and the air of the Spirit that God brings when we gather together. Lord Jesus, thank you for gathering us. Thank you for speaking truth to us. Thank you for empowering us and strengthening us. And thank you, Lord, that when we're the church gathered, it prepares us to be the church scattered. So now, Lord, breathe us out from here and send us in your grace and in your peace and in your power and with your love. We pray in Jesus' name.